Welcome, everybody, to another episode of the Genesis Mindset. And in today's episode, I will be doing more of a coverage on BitMobic. So if you are interested in learning about this in different kinds of ways, I also basically write these in blog format on my website, www.coexistencestephen.com. So I write it on there first and I use that as content for the video. So if you do prefer to learn in that way, you can go there. Also, a lot of these videos do tend to be a little bit on the longer side. I do like to research and put that research together. But if you do prefer shorter form content, you can go to my Twitter at coexiststephen and follow me on Twitter. And I do break down these videos, the key points of the videos, and summarize it on Twitter. So I'll upload the videos on there. So with that said, let's get into the episode. So welcome to the Genesis Mindset. As always, this is mindset for investing, trading, and life. And as you know, this is personal opinion only. It's not financial advice. I'm not a financial advisor. All right, so here we go. So today's episode is going to be about BitMobic's proof of work mining. So it's based on the Bitcoin's proof of work mining. And the main principle behind this is that the proof of work mining creates an unbreakable vault. So we're going to go into that now. Okay, so Bitcoin, proof of work mining. So let's just explain a little bit of terminology. So what even is a miner? So if you do want to know a little bit more about Bitcoin, I'm actually going to leave a link here so you can check out one of the videos that I have done, because as you know, BitMobic is a fork of Bitcoin. So a miner is a node in a network that validates and secures the network, and it's rewarded in the native token. So obviously for Bitcoin, for validating and securing the network, you will get rewarded in Bitcoin. For BitMobic, you're obviously going to get rewarded in the native token, which is Mobic, so MO. So basically what it's doing is you're solving a puzzle and you win the reward. So let's just really explain this down into some very simple, basic terminology. So if you can imagine a sandbox. So in a school playground, there's a sandbox or a sand pit. And we can call this sand pit a blockchain. And there's all these puzzles in there, all different kinds of math problems in that sandbox that need solving. So you can say that that would be the blocks on a blockchain. And so in the sandbox, it's full of children. And so the children are the miners. So you have the sand pit, the blockchain, you have the math problems in the sand pit, which is the blocks on the blockchain. And then you have the children, which is the miners, who want to be the first to solve these puzzles to actually get the reward. So for Bitcoin, it would be in Bitcoin. So to actually solve the puzzles, the children, they'll use different kinds of toys. So in this analogy, the toys would be computers. And the more they have and the faster they are at solving the problems, the more likely they are to solve the problem. So therefore, when one children actually solves a problem, they win the reward. So they win the Bitcoin. And so the rest of all the other children, they see that, and so they therefore agree, okay, this, he won, they're the winner. So they make sure that no one's cheating, so it's a fair system with no arguing. So this is why the blockchain is trustless. So in other words, what it actually requires then, going back to normal terms, is it costs electricity and hardware. So this is why they're rewarded, because they're actually spending their energy to actually get the reward. And they're actually upholding the network. So obviously BitMobic is a fork of Bitcoin. So it uses also proof of work mining. So proof of work is simply just one way of validating a network. You also have proof of stake. And proof of stake is when basically people will already own the tokens or the coins or the cryptocurrencies and they lock them up. So they stake them. That's why it's proof of stake, to secure the network. So it doesn't actually rely on as much computing power. So it's much less energy intensive. So a lot of new cryptocurrencies are moving towards this form, but there's a very specific reason why Professor Orr has actually chosen to go with forking Bitcoin. And the main reason why is because of the vault. So the concept of the vault. So Mr. Orr states it's one of the safest forms of securing the network. So this is one of the key features. This is the big difference between proof of work versus proof of stake. So what he says is basically that it creates a vault where the cost of breaking it, so in other words, the energy requirements, is more than the value of what's inside of the network. So in order to actually break into a network, what you actually need is you need more than 50% of the computing power. So if you have 51%, of the 100% of the network, then you have the power and the capacity to actually break into that network. So therefore, if you break into that network, then you can actually steal everything inside of there. So in this instance, the vault is cracking into the network, cracking into the blockchain, and the reward is all the Bitcoin. So then you can change the code, you can steal the Bitcoin, and it would be the same, obviously, for any fork that utilizes proof of work. However, what he's saying is the actual cost in energy to actually do this is so huge. So the amount of computing power you would need, the amount of energy you would need to produce to get that kind of computing power is more than the value of what's inside of the vault. So this is why it's one of the safest forms, or this is his arguments for why it's one of the safest forms. Now, there are debates around this, whether this is the safest form or not, but this is something that he's simply chosen. So, for example, you could just print an infinite supply of money. So this is one of the reasons why we're moving away from the traditional financial system, is because they're infinitely inflationary, so they continuously print money. So really, you could mount an argument and say, well, a government could just print money, buy a whole bunch of computers and a whole bunch of energy and destroy Bitcoin in this way. To me, this is just an imaginary negative. It's not something that's valid. And if it was something that was valid, then you could also counter that point and say, well, everybody within the network would then work together to prevent this from happening if they saw this beginning to happen. It's probably not as black and white as that. That's just my opinion, though. I could be wrong. Okay, so with mining, as I mentioned earlier, you get rewards. So with Bitcoin, originally, you would get 50 Bitcoins per block. So remember how we called the block the blockchain? So this is something that I explained in previous videos. So each new block is part of the chain of blocks. That's why it's called a blockchain. So when there's a transaction, when something is solved, it goes into the block and that gets attached to the blockchain. So the blockchain is just a string of all these blocks, and they all say all the information from the past is all connected to this one right here in the present. So Bitcoin then, or in this instance, has a total supply of 21 million. Now, what actually happens after 210,000 blocks have been created, then it gets a halvening. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to show this image here. So you can see this orange line. So this is the rewards in Bitcoin. And then the blue line is the value of the rewards. So as you can see, for the first 4 years of Bitcoin, you were receiving 50 Bitcoin as a reward for mining. The value was nowhere near what it is today. So after 210 blocks have been created, then it gets halved. So it went down to 25, and then it got halved again after about 4 years. So it takes approximately about 3 to 4 years for this event called the halvening. And then again, it got halved down to 12.5. And then again, now it's currently at 6.25. So that's where we are at the moment. And so the next halvening event will be around about April of 2024. And so this is why it's called the halvening, because the reward is halved. And this generally creates a surge in the price. So some people debate whether or not this the bull market for cryptocurrency and Bitcoin, obviously, which leads the pack, is related to the business cycles or if it's related to the halvening. So this is still up for debate. Either way, it seems to be once again lining up in that manner where we're starting to see a big surge in the Bitcoin price. There usually is a surge leading up to the halvening. Then there usually is a sell-off and then a continuation of that upward momentum in the price. And this will usually last for about a year after the halvening event. So what we see now also is the same. We're going to start to see the same events occurring in BitMobick. So it occurs in all the different forks of Bitcoin. So BitMobick has exactly the same mining rate as Bitcoin currently, and it's being mined at 6.25 Mobick. Obviously, the rewards per block is very different because the value of Mobick is a lot different. So for instance, the value of Mobick a few days ago was about $167 AUD. So therefore, to actually get a block, so it's $167 times 6.25. That's how much, that's the value of what you're actually earning. So whereas if you look at Bitcoin, the value of what you're earning is over $200,000 US dollars, because Bitcoin is quite expensive at the moment. So, okay, on to the next slide. So the main difference then is, yes, it's exactly the same. So BitMobic will also have a halving event during 2024. But the big difference is Mr. Orr, the founder, before actually launching the network, sped up the mining rate. So he basically, once he forked the network and created his own split of the network, then he sped up the mining rate so he could generate a whole bunch of new tokens. So he generated 14.7 million extra tokens. And these extra tokens are to be distributed as public goods. So 100% of them are to be distributed for public goods. So the public goods are, as I explained in a previous BitMobic episode, is about expanding and growing the network. That's what it's all about. So that's an extremely innovative idea. That's a large percentage of the total supply. So obviously there's this 14.7 million. Then you've got the existing 20 million Bitcoins, which got forked into Mobic. So you also have 20 million Mobic. But those existing holders, first of all, would need to have had it somewhere where it can actually get viewed by the forking. So anything that's on a centralized exchange, forking won't recognize that. So centralized exchanges will not receive any of those tokens. And when you have your tokens, if you have your Bitcoin on an exchange, you don't actually own that. The exchange actually technically owns that. So this is also why you should definitely keep all your tokens off centralized exchanges and use offline. Well, the safest method, in my opinion, is paper wallets. This is a brilliant method that's been designed by Mr. Orr as well. And this is something that we also try to promote with BitMobic. So really, it's a phenomenal idea. So this 21 million, as I was saying before, is going to probably end up being, Mr. Orr's estimating between like 2 to 5 million Mobics that are going to remain from that 20 million, simply because the amount of people who aren't going to even know about the fork that are going to claim their Mobic. So in order to claim your Mobic, you just need to go onto the app and actually connect your wallet and you can claim your Mobic in that way. If you don't claim the Mobic up to January 2029, then all those pre-existing Mobics which aren't claimed are going to get burnt. So he's estimating there's probably going to be around 2 to 5 million that are actually going to be remaining, if not less. I think it was 1.2 million. So not a lot of those existing suppliers are actually going to remain. So then a large majority of those Mobics are actually given away by the founder. So he keeps nothing for himself. It's all given away. It's all locked up in public. It's all in public wallets that he gives away and people track that. Okay, so now just an update on the BitMobic price. So I want you to see here that originally it was decorrelated from the Bitcoin price. As it was going through this airdrop phase, it had no correlation to Bitcoin whatsoever. And it had this huge surge that occurred around towards, I think it was June, July. I can't actually see what do we got? Yeah, so ending towards the end of, to the middle of September, it had this huge surge in price. So it was completely decorrelated from Bitcoin. And then as that euphoria hit, as the end of the airdrop occurred, so the end of the airdrop was around July, so then there was this huge surge, and then there was a massive sell-off. So about, what have we got here? So 230,000 won down to 160,000 won. So let's say there was probably about a 40% sell-off. So there's been a sell-off, and then an accumulation sell-off, and this kind of pattern, you'll see this exact pattern that occurred over a longer stretch of time with Bitcoin, actually, before the previous cycle. This exact pattern happened. So it peaked at about 20,000, and then it had a huge sell-off, rise, sell-off, rise, sell-off, rise, and then it dropped again all the way down to, I can't remember what the price was. I think it was, I don't remember what it was, but this was the 2016-2017 Bitcoin top. And then it dropped down to, he had this huge drop, and then it started to continue its way up. So that's what we're seeing now with Mobic. And just for the record, these charts are completely made by the community. There's no central or decentralized authority that's actually creating this. It's literally just people. So people are keeping track of the price. There's trading chats that are happening on KakaoTalk. And people are actually just keeping track of that. So there's people who are actually the ones who are organizing all the trading and organizing these charts. So it's not actually tracked by any kind of computer. So this is phenomenal. I believe this is just an Excel spreadsheet And so here also you've got the blue line, which is the buy price. You've got the gray line, which is the average price. And then the orange line, which is the sell price. So then the market makers are the ones who actually create that spread. So the ones who are actually running the trading chats. So eventually, obviously, this is all going to be on a decentralized app, so we can actually buy and sell it with ease. But at the moment, it's just completely 100% community run. This is the most community run cryptocurrency that I've ever seen. It's completely unreliant on any decentralized platform. It's completely, like, it's super decentralized because it's not even on a platform. So there we go. So that's the price at the moment. So the price at the minute, as I mentioned earlier, so it's about, as of this, so this was the 4th of November, and that was around about, the average price was 150,000 Korean won. So as I said, it was about 167 Australian dollars. So there we go. There's a BitMobick update. That's what it's all about. That's what the mining is all about. Hope you enjoyed the episode. Please follow me and subscribe, even especially to my blog. I regularly update about BitMobick, and subscribe to the channel if you're interested in this content. And if there's any other content that you'd be interested in learning about BitMobick, please leave it in the chat below. I really want to share this project. I'm really fascinated by it. I really find it extremely interesting. I don't know any other cryptocurrencies like this. It has a lot of unique properties, and also, of course, a lot of similar properties to other altcoins, but the uniqueness is in the public goods. And that's what I'm going to really go into a deep dive over the next few weeks, about all the different sectors that the public goods are targeting and why this is actually going to be so healthy for the growth of the ecosystem. And if it does end up producing the results that Mr. All is hoping for, and the rest of us who are already in it are actually starting to see, then the sky is the limit. At the moment, obviously, at $167 AUD, the price variance between Bitcoin and MoBIC is huge. But eventually, what we're hoping is that price variance is going to get a lot. The gap is going to close. We're not saying it's ever going to get there. Some people are saying, oh, it's going to be more. It's going to be on parity. I don't think it's ever going to be more, personally. I'm not sure it's going to be on parity. But there has been people with a lot of Bitcoin who've actually sold their Bitcoin for MoBIC. So as we start to see some of that happen, as we start to see more value go into the network, then that gap is going to close, especially when people are going to see with their Bitcoin, hang on a minute, maybe 5 years ago or a year ago, one Bitcoin would have gotten me 1,000 MoBIC, but 6 months ago, one Bitcoin's getting me only 500. And then 1 month ago, one Bitcoin's only getting me 200. And then maybe in 2 or 3 years time, one Bitcoin's only going to get me 100. And then maybe they're thinking, well, in the future, maybe one Bitcoin is going to get me 50 or 20 or 10. So this is really what I'm thinking is going to happen as the network continues to grow and continues to expand. So thank you very much for watching. Hope you enjoyed the episode and enjoy the rest of your week. Take care.